Thank you so much for joining me. I'm Julie Philipp. On Tuesday, New York Governor Andrew Cuomo will deliver his 2012 state budget address. He'll explain how he plans to close a $2 to $3 billion budget gap and what his funding priorities will be. I've asked a couple of state assembly representatives from our area in to talk about that and other issues coming their way this legislative session. Welcome Democrat Joe Morelle and Republican Minority Leader Brian Kolb. Thanks for coming in on this snowy morning.
Nice to be with you.
I want to start out, before we get to the budget, talk just briefly about the state of the state where Buffalo got that nice billion-dollar incentive package. Was the Rochester region short-shifted in the address?
Well, I think the governor was trying to, first of all, remind people that upstate New York has some real challenges. He tended to focus on Buffalo. Obviously, he's heard a fair amount over the ensuing few days about perhaps the decision to identify one city as opposed to all the upstate cities and the challenges we face. I think it was more a political speech, and I think he was trying to make a point. The real proof will be in the budget, and I have a feeling at the end of the day we're going to see a distribution of resources that are available to help all of our upstate cities, and I think that's the way it should be.
Okay. Any difference of opinion on that?
No, I agree with Joe on this. I think that one of the reactions we had was most of the state was left out of the shopping cart, at least in the initial speech. But as Joe said, it's more of a 30,000-foot speech than it is specific, detailed, and when the budget rolls out. And also, there's always questions about these initiatives. But quite frankly, I think hopefully working together down the road that with the governor and the legislature, we'll come up with a comprehensive economic development plan that works for the entire state.
The initiatives he did talk about in the state of the state, not cheap. How confident are you that he can find the money to pay for them?
Well, I think that, again, is, you know, it's a big idea speech, and now it gets to the specifics, and that's where we look at the 2012-2013 budget. You know, further reports since the governor's speech is that there's been much more conversation about it's not like there's a lot of state money as part of that economic development package. It's private development investment, and that the state would support it through infrastructure, maybe some land swaps if necessary. But again, until you really see the specifics, it's tough to say, hey, great idea, or maybe not so great idea, and that's why you have to be a little bit patient as this rolls out.
So obviously waiting for Tuesday.
No, I think Brian makes a good point, which is that the governor has really talked about leveraging private dollars. And for instance, he talked during the speech about a convention center being built in Queens at the Aqueduct Racetrack. But as I understand it, and we'll see more this week when he releases his budget, that he doesn't intend to use any public dollars for the construction of the convention center. Instead, the notion is that perhaps some state land could be awarded to the developer for the purposes of building. I don't know how that will work, but I think he's very focused on how to use private dollars. We've even begun to talk about, for the first time in New York, as it relates to infrastructure projects, even beyond that, potentially to engage in public-private partnerships at the state level, which would allow private dollars to come in for the purposes of building public amenities and public infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. So taking the state money and attracting private money with it.
Correct.
A lot more private money than state money. Okay. So when the budget comes out on Tuesday and he releases his plan, what are you looking for? What would be beneficial for Rochester and the Finger Lakes region? We'll start with
Well, the first thing I'm going to do is see what Brian Kolb has to say about it and then take my cues from there. I think for the traditional things, we're going to look to see what kind of school aid we get, not only for the city of Rochester, but for the entire region. We're going to look at the economic development plan. The governor's talked about a second round of economic development council funding in the amount of $200 million. But that won't all be cash. Some of it will be tax credits. So, and obviously, we're going to look at whether or not the governor's continued his commitment to modest growth in education aid and help for our health care, primarily through Medicaid growth. So those are, I think, the initial things we'll look at. We'll look at whether or not there's any broad-based taxes that he's considering in terms of revenue or other revenue enhancements. Are there one-shot revenues that we ought to be concerned about? I think those are that's the initial thing that we'll look at.
I think Joe hit the key. I think education is probably going to be the starting point for the legislature to react to, regardless of where you live. Because, again, there's a planned increase in education spending, and half of that is really already targeted for competitive grants and the building aid and transportation aid. So then there's about $400 million left for to be distributed right now to the rest of the state. And how that's done, has it gone through the original foundation aid, or is it the gap elimination aid, which focuses on those districts that had cuts. So really that's going to be, I think, probably one of the more interesting areas to look out for our area and our region. And certainly the governor's already said no new taxes and fees, but it'll be interesting, as Joe mentioned, that will there be new revenue enhancers that impact our ability to generate revenue. But also, of course, what we're looking for is to try to maintain our spending levels, not to go crazy. And also, unfunded mandate relief for local governments and school districts will be key to see if there's anything in the budget. So really, it's just sort of a wait and see. But these are some of the areas that, you know, I'll be looking at.
Where do you stand on the school distribution issue? How do you think the money should be handed out?
Personally, and I'm speaking for myself, I believe it should be funneled through the gap elimination perspective, because that is really restoring money that has already been cut, so that the districts with the low wealth and average wealth who depend on state aid more, who receive the largest cuts of state aid, would get that money first, and the wealthy districts wouldn't get as much. When you look at the foundation formula, that basically distributes the aid evenly. However, the wealthy districts are going to get more money than I think they probably really need at this time versus the poorer districts, and that's why I favor the gap elimination process versus the foundation aid process.
Okay. Another big issue coming up, possibly related to education, is mayoral control of the Rochester City Schools. Do you see that coming to the floor at all?
Well, we certainly, this was a big issue a couple of years ago. Bob Duffy, then mayor, really led the charge on this. I've had a number of conversations with Mayor Richards. He's opined in the daily newspaper that he doesn't think that this is the priority that we need to focus on right now. There are certainly other issues which are probably more urgent. So I think it's less likely we take that up this year. Obviously, my colleague and friend David Gant has advanced this in the media, that this is something he considers a priority. But I think it's less likely we take that up. There are really some pressing issues facing the city of Rochester and other upstate cities. And I think, from my point of view, I'll take my cues more from the city of Rochester, the city government, and the city school district. We do have facilities modernization plan, which is the rebuilding and rehabilitation of our city schools, which is a priority. City funding through municipal aid is a priority for the city of Rochester. So, you know, typically the local governments will identify the priorities and the things that they think are important. And our job, I see it, is to try to advocate for their priorities, and I think that's likely not to include school governance reform this session.
Okay, I'm going to get into each of your legislative priorities for the year in just a second, but first I want to ask, with all of the rumors of Kodak being teetering on the edge of bankruptcy, is there anything the state could be doing right now to maintain those Kodak jobs that do exist in the community now?
Well, one of the things that that we've been working on for the better part of a year has been the redevelopment of Eastman Business Park, working both with Kodak officials as well as a number of other people from outside of Kodak that are interested in the redevelopment of the site, and really leveraging some of the extraordinary assets in the business park for companies that might want to come in. We've talked to venture capitalists. We've talked to a number of folks. I'm in daily contact with Empire State Development, Mark Peterson over at Greater Rochester Enterprise, the city, about ways that we can do that. So that really takes what could be a huge asset for our community and tries to leverage it. You know, what we can do specifically for Kodak, I think, is a little less clear, partly because I'm not sure exactly what they need. So we have to have more communications, and some of those are ongoing, and we've certainly spoken, you know, over the past several months, and we communicate pretty regularly with Antonio Perez, and obviously they have a huge challenge. It's a great company. It's almost unimaginable to think of Rochester without Eastman Kodak, but there are some challenges in the marketplace, and particularly in the space that they're at, which there may be less that we could do about than we would like, but we're going to obviously pursue whatever we can do and whatever resources the state has at its disposal to help Kodak, and certainly to help the 6,000 plus people in Monroe County who call Eastman Kodak their place of employment.
Okay, let's walk through 2012. The first session is starting, and what are your priorities? What are you hoping to see happen? We'll start with you, Assemblyman Kolb.
Well, I think predominantly we have to start with economic development, jobs, jobs, jobs. Whatever we can do to create the environment for jobs to prosper in New York State is the number one priority. And that means we got to look at trying to remove some of those cost barriers that still inhibit private sector job growth. That's taxes, that's workers' compensation, that's the cost of energy. Certainly, government is not the one that's supposed to be creating the jobs. We're supposed to be creating the environment for jobs to prosper. And I think that has to be our priority. Certainly, when you look at the local taxpayer, the town, village, city, county, I think state government has to have a responsibility to look at dealing with what is commonly referred to as unfunded mandates. For our viewers, it's those costs that state government and the federal government mandate and tell the local governments they have to supply with no or little state aid in terms of dollars coming from Albany. And I think as much as we can do to provide whatever cost relief would help tremendously. And I think one of the largest programs that we still grapple with is Medicaid. We have the highest cost Medicaid program in the country. We have to look for ways to make those dollars spent more efficiently without taking away services from people that need those services the most. But we have our program costs more than the states of Florida and Texas combined, and they have a combined population of 43 million people. So we have to find ways to streamline, innovate, re-energize, rebuild that particular program, because it takes so much of not only the state tax dollar, but also county tax dollars, which, of course, Maggie Brooks talks about all the time, is that the mandates that come from Albany take up a large share of the property tax bill, especially on Medicaid. So I think, as a starting point, those would be the top of my list.
Okay, your turn.
Well, I agree with Brian. There's no question.
Are you sure you're on the opposite side of the aisle?
Yeah, he's really more of a Democrat. I just don't want to tell anybody that.
Go ahead.
I certainly think economic development and job growth. I think the governor and the legislature last year had a great year in terms of trying to address some of the real concerns, but creating jobs. And Rochester and this region, Brian and I have worked a lot on the Center for Infotonics, which is in Canandaigua in his district. Those are the kind of assets that can really create jobs in this region, particularly in the new economy. Second thing that I think is important is we have to continue to get a handle on our fiscal challenges. They are perhaps less acute than they were last year, but they're still significant, and we'll learn a lot more about this week when the governor releases his budget. The other thing that I'm working on as my responsibility as chairman of the insurance committee is to make sure that we can move forward with the health insurance exchanges that we're required under federal law to set up. They can provide real relief potentially for small businesses. We've talked a lot to the business associations like the RBA about healthcare costs and how they're really a drag on their ability to compete. So that's something that I'm spending a fair amount of time on.
Okay. You mentioned that Cuomo has had a lot of success getting his agenda through during his first year. Do you think that will continue in his second year? There is some concern, and I know you will probably bring this up, over his transparency and his lack of ability to get rid of that sort of three men in a room feel in Albany.
Well, I think the governor is really focused on accomplishment and achievement and realizes that there's a pretty significant gap between New York's potential and its performance, and I think he's really trying to close that gap, and I think the first year was very, very, that we did a great job in doing that. I think he'd like to add transparency, but I may be different than most people, and I think transparency is very important. I also think the people of New York expect results, and I think that's where they're placing the priority right now. We face real challenges. I think we'd like to be more transparent, be more inclusive.
I want to give Assemblyman Cole, we got about 45 seconds left. So.
The short version is getting things done is the most important objective here in getting New York back on track, which I totally agree with. Having said that, the bill that was done last year in revising the tax code in December, all of the rank and file legislators weren't even in Albany. And the media found out about this deal before the rank and file legislators had their opportunity to look at it. The bill was done on a message of necessity. I don't think there was any reason for that. There should have been more public debate.
So there's room to grow.
Room to grow in that area, I think, significantly. And yes, I believe in results first, but it also, okay, we are spending taxpayer dollars.
Thank you both so much for your time today and braving the weather.
Thank you, Julie.
New York State Assembly members Joe Morelle and Brian Kolb. You can watch or listen to the governor's budget address next Tuesday starting at 2 in the afternoon. We'll have it right here on WXXI TV as well as on WXXI AM 1370, and we'll stream the audio online at WXXINews.org. We'll also have follow-up reporting and analysis from our Capitol Bureau in Albany.